So we've established our basic menu of available triads, thanks to nature's inbuilt harmonics. We've learnt how to fit a note to a chord, and we've got the idea that major and minor chords feel different in mood. We now also know that chords have mysterious relationships with each other that set up a kind of forward movement or progression in the way they're placed. This last technique is of vital importance to understanding why some harmony sounds great and some sounds rubbish. So let's find out more about chord progressions. All the chord progressions there are in Western music involve some kind of magnetic effect, with the stronger chords attracting and repelling the other chords around them. But there's one relationship that's more fundamental than all the others. The most important partnership between two chords in all Western music is called the tonic-dominant relationship. It's the relationship between the chords based on the first, the tonic, and the fifth, the dominant note of any scale. Each key has its own tonic-dominant chords. In the key of C, for example, they are C and G. Composers like Mozart and Beethoven were enthralled to the tonic-dominant relationship. But it isn't just classical composers who like to rock between tonic and dominant. The dominant note acts like a shadow or an alter ego to the main note, the tonic, and from the 15th century onwards, composers began to see it as an alternative centre of gravity for their tunes and for their harmonies, because they discovered that the dominant chord was dependent on the tonic. It always wanted to lead back to the tonic, and so they used this feature to great effect over and over again. Listen to this. It's the climactic ending of the first movement of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. All it is a series of dominant tonic chords thrashed out one after another. This surely is excessive tonic-dominant syndrome, but Ludwig van wasn't the only one at it. Between 1650 and 1850, all classical composers became infatuated with the tonic-dominant relationship, so much so that they began to construct whole pieces around a journey from tonic to dominant and back again. And if you're going to take a return trip like that, you need to stop at other places on the way. So they put together strings of chords into sequences that did just that. And to see how chord sequences first emerged in Western music, we have to travel back in time to the dance music of Renaissance Europe. The emergence of chord progressions was to be crucial to the development of harmony. In the early 1500s, we see for the first time in printed music the evidence of repeated, durable chord progressions. Dance music was extremely fashionable in the courts of Europe. What seemed to work best was music with strong chord patterns. Two of these became so widespread that they were given the names Passamezzo Antico and Passamezzo Moderno. Both were based on the journey from the tonic to the dominant and back again. The Passamezzo Antico pattern goes like this. That's the halfway point at the dominant, and then we head home again. All sorts of melodies would fit onto that pattern, and you can hear the Passamezzo Antico in action in that most famous of 16th century songs, Greensleeves.
Alas, my love, you do me wrong to cast me out discourteously, for I have
The stately Passamezzo Antico was popular enough, but its successor, the Passamezzo Moderno, was the really big hit. It went on to become the most widely used chord sequence of all time. 500 years after it was first written down, its influence can still be heard.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it.
What was the secret of its success? You see, whereas the Passamezzo Antico was in a somber minor mood, the Moderno was in a sunny major mood. It's a thoroughly organic, all-natural chord progression. It also introduces a third important chord after the tonic and the dominant, the imaginatively titled subdominant. The subdominant was the chord we heard in the second line of Silent Night. Round yon virgin mother and child. And here's a more recent song with exactly the same chord progression. I found my thrill.
Yes, even Blueberry Hill follows the exact pattern of a Passamezzo Moderno.
On Blueberry Hill.
The whole of the Moderno's pattern uses only these three chords, the tonic, the dominant, and the subdominant. The subdominant muscled itself into the picture by acting as a kind of mirror image to the dominant, with the tonic sitting in the middle as a fulcrum.
You'll see that this note, C, is five white notes lower than the dominant, G, and five white notes higher than the subdominant, F. It sits in the middle, holding the balance of power.
These three chords, the tonic, the dominant, and the subdominant, were to become so crucial and so ubiquitous in the centuries that followed that they were known collectively as the primary triads. They're the equivalent of the primary colours in art. Great swathes of Western music rely almost exclusively on the primary triads, from Vivaldi to Elvis.
Well, it's a one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue suede shoe.
So far, we've been talking about harmony as something that's pleasing on the ear, and that's how things were up until the 17th century, when a new and rather naughty idea crept into harmony. Dischord.
Dischord, or dissonance, is where there is a deliberate collision of notes that aren't supposed to fit together, when they belong to the wrong triads, for instance. The issue of dissonance has been something of a battlefield over the centuries. For a start, no one's been totally sure which collisions qualify as a dissonance and which don't. In medieval times, almost everything was classified as a dissonance, whereas by the end of the 19th century, almost nothing was. It has a lot to do, of course, with our ears becoming accustomed to unfamiliar sounds.
If you'd played Jimi Hendrix's Purple Haze to anyone in the Middle Ages, they'd have probably passed out. And yet to our ears it doesn't sound particularly shocking because we've grown used to it. In fact, in terms of pure dissonance, clashing notes, Purple Haze has hardly any at all.
It begins with a collision of two notes that was considered in the Middle Ages such a horrible dissonance that the church authorities called it the devil in music. But even this devilish clash by Bach's time around 1700 was considered more or less harmless. And by Wagner and Tchaikovsky's time, the Romantic era, it was meat and veg to all composers. So is the concept of dissonance gradually dying out then as we get used to everything? The answer is, we seem to be getting used to some dissonance, but not all of it. There are pieces of classical music that were written ages ago that still sound discordant and unnerving no matter how many times you hear them. Take this piece by the French composer Pierre Boulez, written half a century ago.